Okay, I'm going to start with sharing my screen. And share entire screen. All right, so welcome everyone. Good morning from my side. As you can see, good amount of light here. And good afternoon to people on the other side of the planet. I'm so glad and excited to be here. This is my first Our Ladies talk, but I like to talk. And I love R, so I was like, I wanted to grab this opportunity to talk about a few things that I've learned past couple of months from actually a lot of my mistakes. So I hope not to make them. So I wanted to, I sort of committed to this talk because I wanted to, you know, give myself a timeline to streamline my process so that I can do better going forward. So I enjoyed working on, you know, collecting my thoughts together. I hope you also like it. And, you know, hopefully everyone gains something or the other out of this discussion. So I'm going to, this discussion is mostly going to be around different packages that, you know, that aid in our exploratory data analysis. And it would be very industry agnostic and, even maybe, no, I can't say tool agnostic because these are all R packages. It's basically in two parts in the sense that the first part is it, you know, these set of packages you can use at the initial right onset of when you get a new data file, when you're absolutely stranger to it. The other section is when you've probably done some wrangling, again, then you want to start to visualize it and you want to start, tweaking things around. Sometimes you want to save time or sometimes you know, it's that combination of packages where you are looking to either save time versus saving effort to write how much code you want to, because a lot of the things, as you would, agree would be, when you're doing exploratory analysis, not everything that you do, all the codes that you write, all the graphs that you make are not that you keep for your final analysis. So that was the intent behind it. So let me get started, with the content. And I'm going to be shuttling between my deck and a few of the sample, vignettes I've opened just to show you a few examples. And then I'll also be doing, quick demos, not in detail, but a quick overview of some of the packages and how they work. So let's get going. So let's start talking about the exploratory data analysis workflow and the important part being what was the motivation. I'm going to start the timer just so that I know where I am. There was this last a year and a half, I have been working on a lot of research, open-ended exploratory projects where, either we didn't know exactly where we want to land because, like I said, it's open-ended and there were set of questions we would start with. Sometimes absolutely no questions were there. And while I was doing those things, I figured that the process that I was following, a lot of codes that, ggplot codes that I was writing, they were repetitive in the sense that, I'm making bar plots to understand maybe, to get the frequency counts of certain users. And then I would think, oh, how about I look at it from gender perspective, or how about I look at it from the geographical regions perspective? Are things different? And sort of moving from there, the more you do these, data slicing, and the more questions you're trying to answer. I mean, the more graphs you make, then if there are some good inputs, insights that you can get out of it, you then end up following up with following questions and things like that. So what happened in this past couple of projects was, the things were being repetitive. I figured I was actually going back to my old code, copy pasting things. And then, all my projects, I remember two or three of them were taking so much time that we had initially bucketed for them. Thankfully it did decrease, that delay did decrease as I moved from project one to two and three. But I felt very uncomfortable that, the amount of time that I was spending on coding these things, I was not, spending so much on insight generation, and because I was running out all the time. So I was like, okay, let's stop. And I was stopping because it was like, way past my timeline. And then I was like, I have to submit something. I have to talk about the outputs. But it wasn't my, it wasn't my happy place. I was like, let me maybe streamline some things that I want to do, maybe some set of quotes that I want to write and that I just, use all the time. So in the same spirit, I started doing some research and I found that there were already existing some of the some of those packages which kind of, replicate this philosophy. So let's start digging in. So absolute first steps, like I said, the part one being, just when you get a new data file, you, in some cases, you would already have some background to it. You might have some questions about it, but sometimes you may not, especially if situations like, if I participate in a hackathon, I don't know anything, but if I start spending time on each and every variable and start plotting it or start looking at it, we generally do a summary, you do head and tail, but you don't tend to spend time on all the variables and practically so. So let's look at a few things that are very helpful that I found very helpful in this such a scenario. So I found this package called Data Explorer. I think in their own words, they say that it is aimed to perform and simplify three important tasks. And for me, it sort of certainly, still revolves around exploratory data analysis, but they say exploratory data analysis, feature engineering, and data reporting. And it has a huge set of functions that it, offers to perform all of these things. Let me actually take you through that. So it basically gives you a quick overview of how many missing values you have for all the variables that you have in the data set. It gives you distributions of all the numeric variables. It actually also does a correlation, a big correlation map, I think that's called. It also brings out the principal component analysis. It starts slicing your data based on categorical variables for the exploratory data part. Now then it starts, it also allows you to do feature engineering. If you want to replace missing values, so you have to do, you have to dig deeper into what you want to do once you know your data a little bit. And then the third part is data reporting, which is sort of what I picked up the most or found the most useful, because this function called create report, and this is a housing data that I was trying to sort of replicate for demo purposes. So this is from a ggplot2 package. So create report function within this package, it provides you with all the all the functions that it provides, like I've mentioned here, and I'll share this link. So it pretty much does all those plotting functions, all those missing value checks, all the summaries and everything it brings out to you with this one function. So so this is an example I ran on the Texas housing data using create report from Data Explorer package. So what it is doing is it gives you basic stats, which is, of course, it's good to start with the, in other words, I generally used to look at DIM or number of rows, number of columns, and all of that it gives you here. You can quickly see how many rows and columns you have, how many, continuous discrete variables you have, how many categorical variables you have, whether you have complete rows or not. And then it starts plotting all of that information as well. So it gives you a quick data structure of how many, what are the names of the variables, character, integer, and numeric, and all those values based on, however R reads and imports them. It starts guessing based on certain values. It then gives you a missing data profile for all the for all the variables. It'll give you a univariate distribution, which is frequency. I guess I'm not gonna go through why these numbers are like this, because this is how they are. Then from the modeling perspective, QQplot becomes very important, because this basically just gives you a sense of, is your data is this variable normally distributed? So you can look at that and also start thinking, if it's not normal, then if you want to use this data this variable, do you want to transform it? So, that kind of gives you a little heads up in your head, even though you're not transforming right away. And then this is the correlation plot that I was talking about, or correlation map. So it brings out all those columns, obviously all the numeric variables here, and you know, gives you that matrix of how strongly correlated these are. And then there's a color scale of how the correlation, calls it correlation meter, of minus, from minus one to one. Moving forward, it also gives a principal component analysis. But again, this is, I personally have not used a lot, but again, for someone who's actually looking at it from the modeling perspective, can also, you know, get deeper into this. Yeah, and that's about the sort of set of outputs that you can see. But I see, you know, you can see that it gives you, like, in just one function, like, you just run it for, like, it takes a couple of seconds, and then it gives you so much of information, you know, rich analysis of your data already. And it saves you, I would say, maybe a day's work. So yeah, so this is one. I want to talk about data reporter package. And this, I got excited when I found out about this, but when I ran it, I felt like maybe this is very repetitive, but this does have certain benefits of its own. I agree a lot. Some of the things that it does, is, again, similar to what Data Explorer does. It will give you the missing values, different characters, what is the behavior, sort of like a quick behavior of each of the individual variables. But let me do a quick demo of one of the reports that I want to show. I'll talk about the defaults later. So this is a variable list that it generates. This is how it starts. So first is just the title slide. Then it gives you a complete data review, similar to what we had seen earlier. Then it, in a very nice and quick table format, it tells you how many, what are the data types, and how many of them are, miscoded, missing values, how much white spaces. I think the most important part here being is that this package aims at actually doing a lot of data checks, like data quality checks, and it summarizes all that. If you're going to look forward, is sort of a summary on those lines. So again, like I said, so it is also great use of your time, because, and it is a lot of, and again, it's a data check is one of the important, and I would say less fancy, like, I don't know what's the right word, but less fancy term, but again, very useful from the data exploration or even modeling perspective, because once you know the quality of each of the variables that you're going to be using in your model, it just helps. It'll help you right away. Do better work or make a better model. Like, I would say garbage in, garbage out concept, just sort of a recap on that. And just to reiterate that's why the quality of your, all the columns or all the features that go into your model is so important. It's sort of a similar one, because it tells you how many unique values you have, what data type this variable has, and how many missing values you have. But again, like I said, it's a quick summary. It's a good way to look at it. You can see, okay, maybe 6 or 7% missing is fine. The new thing here is that it tells you, does it have a problem? And then if you see a check mark, that means these are the ones which you want to look at, because in this case, it's sort of indicating the missingness. Let's dig deeper into what does it think is sort of an issue, thing that can cause an issue. Again, now at individual feature level, it is going to start giving you details. This is sort of summary. We have seen these. We can do the summary function, if that's the thing. So it's nothing new. But what I do like about this piece is, this information about outliers. So it starts to, and it may not necessarily be the thing, but it gives you a sense of, like caution. Like, you can see, okay, I see that these things have been pointed out. Let me dig deeper into it and let me verify, are these actually outliers? So again, it's better to do all that data treatment right at the onset, like in first week of your project, rather than doing all the modeling and then realizing, oh, I think this is something we missed. So, and then going back and doing the iteration. So yeah, that's how I sort of found this very helpful. And then in the end, it just sort of gives you, like your session info kind of thing, which is useful from repeatability perspective, but not all the time. So, but just good to know. All right, so I'm gonna go back to my deck. And so that report that you saw was a PDF format that was generated using just this one function from the data reporter package. It also allows you to use different functions in parts if you would like. But like I said, similar to this concept for me, I found this one function as the most important or the most useful one. Again, I have actually linked all these packages with my package name titles here. So I'll be sharing this later, so it'll be easy to access. And just for a quick reference, this is the package vignette on the GitHub page of the people who have designed it. So you can look more into it. It also, I think this report, when you run this function and you get this report, so PDF is one, and it also automatically generates an RMD file for it. I think it's the different package. I'll come back to that. Yeah, it's Grunt. We'll come to that. All right. So, and then another package in this part one that I want to talk about is the schema package. This package is, again, this has it also has multiple functions. I'll show you the vignette. It's here. It provides so much of information from both for the categorical variables, both a lot of it for the numerical variables. It gives you the distribution in a very small, small multiple format, which is very tiny. But again, for a quick reference, it tends to be really useful. It allows you to also, it provides you functions where you can actually do all of this, even for a group data set, if you want to, but again, from the starting point, you would always, I personally always want to use skim function, like the skimr dot dot skim function on my data set. What that does is something like this, where it brings up the data summary, similar thing that we've seen. Then it starts to break your data by data type. So if you have factor variables, then how do they look like? If they're numeric variables, how do they look like? So this gives you basically a five numeric summary, and it gives you a histogram. What is interesting is that you can actually start to take out, there's a function called yank in this that I found interesting that I've used is, I want to see, I think it's in the end. So the yank function also allows you to take out each portion of the report that it generates. For example, if you're only interested in this section, so you can skim the package and then yank this section. So that kind of makes it very interesting. And then, you could, if this is the tabular form that you want to take it out and maybe make it more pretty, you can use GT function after the pipe to do further designing of things that you want to do. So again, lots of functions inside it to use sort of get things out in the smaller part of this report, but the overall report can be generated just using this. And one quick difference, I think, if I were to bring out in all of these, which is from the analysis point of view, it's probably not so important, but just good to know, is that when you run the report, when you create a report using Data Explorer, it will by default give you an HTML format file. Data Reporter gives you a by default PDF files, and the skim function, it generates a report in the console, but they have options to sort of modify you know, the defaults and if you want to change things. So I have also used skimr skim function in an RMD format. So then, you know, it basically just gives you, then it continues to give you things in results in the HTML format as well. So that's one way to change it. And I guess I want to pause and see if there are any questions or any comments on if I'm going too fast.
I don't see any comments.
Okay.
And if, yeah, but just shout out if anybody has any comments or.
All right. So is the pace okay? Should we keep going or do you want me to slow down?
Nobody wants to talk, but I think it's okay. But okay. Yeah, I see thumbs up by somebody at least.
All right. Okay. So I'll keep going. Yeah, and feel free to ask questions if there's anything that you want me to talk more about. And if I don't have an answer, I guess I can share the resources so that you can look further. All right, so next steps. When you have a little bit of sense of you know, how your data looks like, things that I found interesting, and this is the place where I was saying where this research was mostly to see, to figure out, you know, on my spectrum of do I want to write a lot of code or do not want to write a code at all. So these packages provide me an option to play around with that spectrum, because they all have different capabilities. I mean, some of them obviously are similar and, you know, they kind of overlap. But again, it's a judgment call and it's about what I'm trying to do and what can help me do it faster and in a better way. All right, so I'm gonna start with the package called R Pivot Table. So I think I really enjoyed looking at this, you know, when I figured out about this package, was because it kind of provides me, you know, like a pivot table within R, which is interesting. And the fun part is that it's pipeable. So it lets me do a quick and dirty data exploration within my R, you know, ecosystem. In terms of the demo, it's very simple. The you know, you have to import the package. You install the package. You import it or load it using library call, and then you run the pivot table function on you know, whatever data you have. So right now it's not going to show up here, but let's do a quick look at this. Let's see here. So I think I cleaned up my console before starting, but let's see, I hope things work. All right, yeah, so it does. Okay, so yeah, I think for me, it was a lot of fun to look at a resource like this, because like I was mentioning, when I was working with the user level data, the data that I had was at a very granular level, in the sense that, you know, how are people using this app? Did they log food? Did they do exercise and things of that nature? So when I was, you know, looking at things in trying to answer different questions while looking at the data, one thing that I would always end up checking is when I did this filter, how much, you know, how much did I lose in terms of my users? So since I have, you know, like multiple records per user, I would always have many records, but the number of users, for to find the number of users, I had to, every time I had to do my data pipe distinct, and then I would say count my, you know, then I would say select user ID, and then I would say give me a count. So again, I guess this is not difficult, but I was doing a lot of filtering multiple times. I was, you know, multiple iterations of things that I was doing. So like, why do I have to copy this all the time? So I, you know, that's the place where this works the best for me, because, you know, like I said, this is sort of a pivot kind of view for me. And the unique, you know, with the multiple records for each user, I wanted to look at the unique users I have at this point when I filter. So before I filter, I can run this, and then I filter, and then I pipe it, and then I say, okay, now how many users do I have right now? So I can look at this from this perspective. So within in this data for Texas housing, we have like 8,706 rows, I think. And for when you look at that, you know, there is, we're talking about houses that are sold in different cities in Texas. So at this point, you know, we're starting with 46 cities. Maybe if you do some more changes to the data, you know, you remove missing values, I do na.omit, let's say, for example. And then after that, how many cities am I left with? Is it like only 23 cities left? So that's like, I already lost like half of the data. Do I want to do it? You know, those kind of questions are very quick, and you can just, you don't have to do a lot of code. You can just see what you're doing and how does the data look like. So if, for example, I want to see how many years worth of data I have. So when I was doing, and I was preparing for this discussion, I saw like the, I was like 16 years. So 2000 to 2015 data, this data set has. So that was interesting to see. Again, I did not have to do a lot of, you know, things for finding this out. The fun part, you know, if additional fun you want, it also actually in the default is table, which is why I said pivot table, but then it also lets you do, you know, pivot charts along with it. So here, okay, we are only looking at year, I guess, if I could add city, let's see how that would look like. Probably I should have filtered for 1 year and then see, but yeah, I mean, just for an example that, you know, you can again further change your visual in many different ways. So again, I guess this is fun to for a lot of trial and error kind of things. And when you say, okay, this is good, I guess now is a point where you want to actually go back and code, but you already have a, you know, mental model of what you did, and that would be like a, you know, sort of quicker way to go back and code. So moving forward, so I just want to sort of summarize in this table, in this package, what I found was, you know, it's great. It's like a pivot kind of look and feel for me, but within being my R ecosystem, I don't have to go out of my R studio, open an Excel and do all of that. You know, being able to get those unique counts was the easiest way in here. But then again, it gives you more than just the counts, and you know, having that variety kind of gives you a lot of freedom and flexibility. So that's, I think, great. Like I said, it's pipeable, and that's another awesome way to be able to use this. You know, you don't have to stop and create a new data set to test anything. You can just go with the flow, keep testing what questions you get in mind, which is great. So limitations, I guess, is that, like I said, in the end, you don't have the code of, things that you are doing. So it doesn't automatically generate that code. And the reason why I think I bring this up here is because in the next package, we would see that it does. So it was kind of a comparison in that sense. I guess that's with the benefits that it gives you kind of is, you know, it's like, what is it? What is important, or sort of, if it allows you to try five things and then you can pick and choose one and then code one, I guess it's worth it. And I say colors again, and I think I've just mentioned for the limitations from the point that, I mean, there is limitation, but I guess they're not so important of a negative limitation in that sense. And color, basically, I'm trying to say is, you know, I can't add a lot of coloring by myself. Like I can't stand, like I have to go with whatever it gives me. I can't change things in that sense a lot, because obviously there's no code that I can do in here, which is the premise that we started with. So I think we're good. Next is Esquisse. I think this is another interesting one. It's been in the ecosystem, I guess, for a while. And I always wonder every time I look at this, is why is it not so famous like Janitor and, you know, other packages? Because this provides you, you know, a UI kind of thing. Again, being in your R ecosystem, it's like, I think I've heard it's a Tableau-esque kind of a package, or the UI that it gives you. I actually should have taken a snapshot and shown that picture, but we can actually do that. So in terms of what it does for you, or what it allows you to do, is it lets you do quick exploration. you can do some level of wrangling on the go, in the sense that, you know, it allows you to filter things from, it gives you, for every numeric value, it will give you the slider kind of input, which you can, you know, move. For categorical variable, I believe there is this checkboxing that you get, and you can, you know, select or unselect those values. And the best part that, you know, and again, this is all ggplot in the backend. So after, you know, based on whatever changes you are doing, it adds the code in the backend, you know, under the hood for you. If you want, there's a, and I'll show you. So there's a section which says code snippet. And then if you click on that, you actually can get, so whatever you did prior to that step, whatever code was technically needed to get to that, that you can get that code as well. And you can send it to the source, you can send it to console, and which again makes life so much simpler, because, you know, you tested things just by UI, and then you don't even have to code. And, you know, you get, you maybe, let's say again, tested five things, you wanted, you liked one, and you're like, okay, get me the code, and it's just done with it. Move forward. So yeah, that's the fun part. Again, so very simple syntax. You get the library and then you run this function. I've not even seen or gone into the package to see if there is a, there are the functions, honestly, but this just does that for me. And in fact, when you install this package, it also brings up an add-in in the RStudio. Let's quickly take a look at it. So it's basically a sort of a Shiny app built in through this package. All right, so let me bring up Esquizze. I'm gonna run this. So this is how it looks like. So this is that Shiny thing. It brings up whatever data frames you have in your environment. It'll let you choose that. You can actually choose you can change your environment as well. So when you select the data, you can actually view your data quickly. You can update the, you know, like if you want to coerce any data column from one format to, for, you know, another, or change the data type, you can. I generally don't do it if I have to do it this way, because I would probably then tend to forget. And if I have to, let's say, convert something from numeric to factor, I would do that in the code and then pipe it to this. But then again, you know, sort of choice. So then basically, once you have the data, you want to import it, and it will give you this pane, which is what I was saying is sort of Tableau-esque, in the sense that, you know, it allows you, this is the canvas that it is going to plot your graphs on. In here is that limited set of plots that it is going to allow you to make. So for example, let's look at one column at this point, and it, you know, also, you know, smart enough to sort of try the, you know, sort of look at the best option that your with your given data type it is. And then, you know, it took this volume variable and it made the plot. I'm going to reduce this here. And then these are the options that I was saying. It allows you to save. You can click on this and, you know, save your image of your plot. You can edit your plot. You can add the titles, caption, title, subtitle, and all of these things. There are plot options. You can, so since this is a histogram, you can change your number of bins. You can change xlim and ylim. You can change the the stat function. You can flip your coordinates if you would like. And yes, this is awesome. So all the theming options, or all this. All the options that you get with all the geoms and within ggplot, all of that kind of is allowed to be changed in some way or the other in these options. You can change your theme. You can change the position of the legend if you have. Now, this is the place that I was saying for wrangling that makes sense. You can sort of filter out the values. Again, not very easy to do it, like if there's specific, you know, number you want to get to, I would say, but I guess this is what I mean, this I think I find it really good. And then the last and the most fun part, you know, whatever I did, you know, it generates the code for it. You can copy to the clipboard, you can insert this code into the script, and voila, you just had fun, made many different plots, and then you didn't even have to write the code. And then after that, I'm just gonna close it. And all right, so going back, so benefits, like I said, I think compared to all the different packages that you've seen, this allows you that flexibility and a lot of freedom to do what you're trying to do, and along with generating that code. So I guess that's the biggest plus point for me as compared to others. But like I said, with others, you know, there were other reasons why I would still tend to use them. The limitations that I found was, you know, again, it doesn't give you a lot of summary of the data, but that's what it is meant for. You know, it's supposed to be, it's meant for the visual purposes. You're already supposed to have known your data prior, and you know, you already have a sense of it with other packages that we've seen, so it's fine. And then with the plotting, you know, it had only a limited option, so you can't make any complicated plots with it, you know, to save time on getting your code generated. But I guess this is still a good chunk of, you know, bunch of options that it provides, because they cover a good deal of, you know, visualizations that we tend to use in a normal scenario or a business and data analysis situation. All right, so moving on to the last one, Chronicle. Now this is one package that I think found out about most recently, and thanks to USAR 2021 for that. This is a package which, again, allows you quick exploration and also does report generation for you. So sort of a mix of few things that we saw in different packages so far. Again, this also runs, you know, ggplot under the hood, but it sort of wraps them in different into functions. So the functions that it provides you is, you know, it doesn't provide you, you're not writing ggplot2 code when you use this package or you use functions within this package to generate plots. But what ultimately is happening is, you know, it still is the ggplot2 code. And I want to show that using this. So this make bar plot, for example, is a function in Chronicle package. So, you know, it says that, you know, you have make underscore star functions, and then you have add underscore star functions that are part of Chronicle package. But what is actually happening inside is still this ggplot2 code. So just wanted to sort of bring up, this is what you would see if you went into their GitHub repository. So I just took a few screenshots from there to talk about, you know, what's actually happening. So we still have ggplot2 happening under the hood. So, you know, which means basically that your look and feel, your visual is still gonna be the same. Except that it saves you you know, pain or time or effort of going into all the different pieces that you have to plus into your ggplot2 code to get to what you're trying to achieve, right? And then sort of you can standardize your methodology with this way. So from the demo purposes, like I was mentioning, so it has add underscore star functions that you want to use in your code, and then that add underscore star functions, for example, add underscore bar plot and add underscore whatnot, ultimately calls a make function, which you know, is the plot for what type of chart it is going to make. Again, it also allows you from the second point, like I mentioned earlier, report generation, it also allows you, it gives you a render report function, which is, what do I say, under the hood, actually runs R markdown render function. So similar to the other packages that we saw, right, Data Explorer, it is also ultimately running a report for you. You know, so it has this whole big chunk of code that is written under the hood, and you just call the function, and then, you know, a new RMD is created for you. So pretty much the same thing. Now this package, again, also has this package has a function called report underscore columns, which is using skimr, skim function. So we talked about what this does, and it sort of, you know, is running that under the hood. So it is is collecting all the good things from all the good places and giving you that rich summary of your data and giving you good and giving you time back to generate insights. So I guess I'll come back to that with a quick demo of the Chronicle package. So you can, you've got to import this. You want to write down group of add functions you want to use. You can pipe them all together and then save it in an object, and then you can call that in a report, render report function. So I'm going to run this. Let's load the library, let's define it, and then let's render the report. Okay, last minute thing, something didn't work, but I have the results here. So HTML. All right, so this is a quick Chronicle demo. So this is the title that you can mention here. This is the output of the quick Chronicle demo. So this is the title of the report, and this is the output. So this is where you start, you've gotten the report. That's one function. It allows you to then, start adding content to your report. So now all of this section is what comes from your object, and it is allowing you to add text. It lets you add a table. It lets you add the visuals in whichever way you like, as many as you like. And I think for me personally, the biggest advantage of using this style of generating plots has been this one, because I have recently learned about this rain cloud plot, but it's complicated to me because it's more than one plot that you have to make, and you have to group them things together. So I think from what I understand, rain cloud, I think is a combination of three plots or three chart types. So you're looking at the distribution, you're looking at the box plot, and then you have the jitter plots. So the usage of which I find is really immense, that you if you look at this, you would tend to make less mistakes, especially if your distribution is bimodal, right? Or if your relationship is not linear. If everything looks good, if it is a normal distribution, I guess, which is great, then probably looking at it wasn't really helpful in diagnosing an issue. But if there is, that's the situation when it's more helpful. Because if it's good, then you would look at just one distribution and then you're fine with it. But this adds a lot of value when things are not as you expect them to be. Just looking at one of these gives you a sense of how correctness of the variable, which may not be the case. And that's why rain cloud plot being rather more useful than each of these individually. And so for me, being able to get to that code was very difficult. And I found for this one, I found, okay, add rain cloud plot, done. That's it. I can group it if I need to. I can, look at whatever variable I want to look at. And I guess that's so simple and, so easy. So this was basically the code to add the content that you want in your report. This is how you would call the report. Another fun part, I guess, is that it allows you to, render report function, it can make or it can generate more than one output format at a time. So if you see here, I mentioned PDF and RMD formats. So it actually generated an RMD for me, and it also generated PDF here. The output should look a little different. So this is a quick demo output. I didn't click it. Okay, so for some reason, I'm not able to open or click this one, this file. But yeah, the same output that we saw here, this is the HTML version of it. We can also get a PDF version of it, you know, depending on what your stakeholders would prefer when you are ready to share with them. And yeah, and then this is the GitHub repo for that. I've tried to, you know, bring up, 1 second, I'm trying to move this thing around. So I guess I didn't show this, there is, so I opened all the, you know, the vignettes for all of these packages that I have talked about. There is a lot of fun you can do with these. And yeah, I guess this was the last package for demo. And, you know, in terms of benefits, like I said, I think for me, the rain cloud plot, getting to be able to do that in like a minute was the big win. It saved me so much time in being able to get that plot, even without losing the ggplot2 style or, you know, that overall ggplot look. If, you know, that's if other plots, that's how they look, and, you know, I can keep the same theme and keep things very, very much in the same style. It can generate reports in multiple formats, like I mentioned, in just one rendering. I don't have to do, you know, render multiple times. So it creates different versions of your RMD file based on how many formats you've asked for. And again, there is no ggplot2 code per se, but like I said, you know, it still is the same thing under the hood. And I should have a thank you slide, but this is all that I have. Thank you so much for patiently listening to my chatter.